Welcome to OpenBXRX Tuesday on BronxNet. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez, and I'd like to invite you to get social with us at BronxNet TV on Instagram and Twitter and BronxNet Community Television on Facebook. The Delta variant has quickly become the dominant strain in the United States, and COVID-19 infections in New York City are climbing for the first time in months as a variant gains traction here in our city. What exactly is the Delta variant? Why are there so many variants showing up? Joining us now to share more is Dr. Eric Meyerowitz, Infectious Disease Specialist at Montefiore Medical Group. Welcome, doctor. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks so much for having me and talking about this important topic. I'm glad to be here with you today.
Of course, always appreciate our experts at Montefiore making the time to join us to speak about these topics. Doctor, so right off the bat, how many COVID-19 variants are there currently? What should we be looking out for?
There's a handful of variants that are being watched closely around the world. The things that groups are looking for when they're following these variants are whether there are changes in and how easily transmissible a particular virus is, and whether it has any differences in terms of the clinical severity of infection as compared to some of the older viruses, and in the most severe situation, whether infection with a particular variant might evade the immune response in people who are vaccinated. It's important to say there is no variant that is circulating that has evaded immune response in vaccinated people.
If we can emphasize that, doctor, what exactly does it mean? It means that vaccinated folks can't get infected by these new variants?
So the vaccines provide about a 95% reduction in the risk of getting infection, both with the wild type and pretty close to that with these variants. So what that means is that if you were in a room with people who were vaccinated and unvaccinated and you had the same exposure, so maybe there was a person with COVID-19 who was in the room who was coughing and there was a lot of the COVID-19 virus in the air. If you had 100 people who were vaccinated and 100 who were unvaccinated, maybe about 100, maybe all of those who were unvaccinated would end up with infection because it's a high risk environment, right? You're indoors, you have someone who's coughing and is infectious. Of the people who are vaccinated, maybe five or fewer would end up with infection, right? That's what the 95% protection means. Now, it's also important to say among those who do get infected, that's called a breakthrough infection, right? So when you have a vaccine and then you get and then you actually are in a situation where you become infected, that is what is called a breakthrough infection. Those breakthrough infections tend to be mild among vaccinated people, whereas if you're unvaccinated, you're likely to have you're at risk for having the sort of severe infections that we've been seeing. For most of the last year or more.
Thank you for breaking that down, doctor. Yeah. Why are so many COVID-19 variants showing up now, a year after the first outbreak in the United States?
That's a really great question. So the way that a variant happens, if I'm infected with a virus, for instance, the virus will actually get into my cells. So those red parts on the edge of the virus that kind of look like spikes. That's how the virus actually gets into our cells. Once it's into our cells, it starts to replicate and make new viruses. And each time that it replicates, because it is an RNA virus, meaning that the genetic material that makes up the COVID virus is RNA. Unlike our genetic material, our primary genetic material is DNA, right? So this virus is an RNA virus. All RNA viruses mutate at a certain rate, and it tends to be a slow rate. And so you don't see an accumulation of mutations very quickly. It's going to take time for those mutations to accumulate and to then be seen spreading in the community, and likely most people who are infected with the COVID virus, whether it is the current variants or the original what's so-called wild type virus, most people have a short period of active viral replication, probably around a week or so, and then they clear the infection, right? So there's a period of about maybe 5 to 7 days where people are infectious. There are people who don't have a normal immune system, so maybe on some significant medications that suppress or weaken their immune system. They may have certain cancers or other autoimmune conditions that weaken their immune systems. Uncontrolled or untreated HIV/AIDS is another situation where you have a very weak immune system. In people like this, it may be possible to have a longer period of infection, kind of a more chronic infection. And you can imagine in that situation, you have a lot more replication of the virus. So rather than having the virus replicate for about 5 to 7 days, it might replicate for a couple weeks or even a couple months. And if that's happening, you get more opportunity for the virus to make mistakes, for there to be mutations, and these can accumulate over time and then spread to another person. Most of the mutations aren't going to be seen in future viruses, but there are some that through chance are going to give the virus a better ability to survive. So maybe there's a mutation that allows it to get into your cells a little bit easier, or to be a little bit more transmissible, right? Meaning that if I just had an infection and I have virus replicating in some of my cells, and maybe there is one virus that has acquired a mutation that allows it to transmit to another person a little more easier, that virus is more likely, right, to leave me and to get into the next person, right? And so over time, you could imagine that you might see the accumulation of some of these mutations and the emergence of these so-called variants. And that's kind of what's happened.
Got it. And speaking of mutations, doctor, the Delta variant is being referred to as a double mutant. What exactly does this mean?
Yeah, that's a great question as well. So what from studying all of the various variants that have emerged so far all around the world, scientists and researchers and virologists have found that there are particular mutations, right? Particular changes that do give the virus a selective advantage, meaning things that make the virus maybe get into your cells a little bit easier, right? Or get into another person a little bit easier, right? Right. These are the sorts of things that are of an advantage to the virus, and that are likely to be selected for and to accumulate over time. So it turns out that the Delta variant has two of these mutations that we know are important.
And are the symptoms different with the Delta variant as opposed to the normal variant that we were dealing with?
So even though we're calling it, even though it's technically a variant and we're following it closely, the disease is still COVID-19. So the same symptoms that you might see in someone with the old COVID-19, you know, like a year or so ago, are the same that you'd expect to see in someone who's infected with one of these novel variants. It's important to say that there one of the things that makes COVID-19 difficult to diagnose is that there's really a tremendous severity spectrum, and there's a huge number of possible symptoms, right? So there are some people who are completely asymptomatic throughout the whole period that they're infected. There are some people who may just lose their sense of taste or smell. There are some people who have more like sort of a mild flu-like illness, and then there are people in the worst case, right, who end up needing to be hospitalized, who get a pneumonia from this, who have severely low oxygen levels, and who sometimes need ventilation and extra oxygen, right, which are things that we do in the hospital. So all of those various spectrum are still expected to be seen again, whether you have infection with one of the old types or with one of the new variants.
Doctor, a recent rare case actually surfaced on a woman developing a co-infection with two variants. How likely is this, and how does that even happen?
So we think typically when you are infected with COVID-19, right? Let's go back to that room that I talked about earlier, where you're in a room, someone has COVID-19, they're in the infectious period, perhaps they're coughing, you're indoors, there's poor ventilation, maybe people are not wearing masks. What we think happens is one virus probably is gets into you and gets into an area where it can get into your cells. The most likely area that's happening is in your nasopharynx, so up in the nose, in the mouth, and possibly occasionally deeper into your lungs, into what's called your lower respiratory tract. And so typically we think infection is set up with a single virus. There may be situations where you could see multiple so-called founder viruses get into a person at the same time and set up infection. You know, if they're coming from the same source, they're probably likely to be the same virus, right? So let's say that I was infected with the Delta variant, that variant is going to be the one that is in my cells and that is replicating, and we're going to be seeing new viruses that resemble the Delta variant, and that's what if I were coughing, that's what I would be expelling and potentially exposing other people to. So probably from one source, you're likely only to be at risk of one variant. So in a situation like the one you described, you know, one possibility is that there's some sort of lab contamination, right? We think we're seeing someone with infection with two different variants. However, perhaps the samples came from different people, or I suppose in very, very rare situations, if you were in a situation where there were a couple different people with infectious virus who had different variants themselves, you could potentially be exposed in that situation. And the more likely situation would be if you had been infected in the past, right? Maybe had a mild case. We do know that you can rarely get early reinfection, so we can see reinfections as early as about 3 months. So if I got infected 3 months ago, maybe with the old type virus, and now maybe the antibody protection that I had had kind of gone away. I wasn't vaccinated, and then I'm infected. I'm in an area where I'm exposed to someone with one of the new variants. It's possible that I could have two different variant infections, but at different time points.
Got it. Thank you for breaking that down, doctor. It's super important information that otherwise we wouldn't understand on our own. So it's important to have you here with us. So you did bring this up earlier, but just to emphasize, how do vaccines fare up with natural immune response to these new variants? And plainly, can vaccinated people still get infected with the new variant?
Yeah, this is like probably the critically important question, right? So what we know is that the vaccines that we have are actually some of the best vaccines that are out there that have ever been developed in terms of how effective they are at preventing disease. So that is true for the wild type virus as well as for the variants that are out there so far. So to say that again, none of the variants that are circulating right now are evading the immune response of people who are vaccinated, and the best thing that we can do actually to prevent more variants from emerging, and if we let COVID go on and on and on, right? If more people get infected, there's more opportunity for mutations to accumulate, and there will certainly be more variants that emerge. So the best thing that we can do to prevent that is to try to help get people the information they need to get vaccinated as soon as possible, right? Because if you're vaccinated, then you're blocking the ability of of the virus or the variants to cause infection in you and to accumulate more mutations and for more variants to emerge.
Thank you so much, Dr. Meyerowitz, for your time today and for sharing more information on this. Thank you. We appreciate you.
Thanks so much for having me again. Take care.
You as well. We'll be right back here on OpenBXRX Tuesday.